Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Bathurst Presbyterian Morning Church. My name is Bryson, and we really hope that this morning's online experience will be an encouragement for you. So let us know that you're there by leaving comments in the chat. Feel free to interact with us or interact with each other in that chat as well. If you're here for the first time, it's really lovely to have you join us. If you'd like to find out some more about our church, or you'd like to investigate Jesus some more, please don't hesitate to contact us through our church website. This morning, we're continuing in our series in the Old Testament book of Judges. And disappointingly, it's again a Bible passage all about human failure. And yet, ironically, it's a passage that will also give us great hope, because it's a passage that shows us God's patient mercy at work despite human failure. Let me pray. Father God, thank you so much for this technology that enables us to connect in this way this morning. Thank you that even in times of pandemics and change and upheaval, you are still there, you are still caring for us, and you are not silent, but that you speak to us through your word. And so this morning, please continue your good work in us by instructing us and comforting us from your word, so we might trust and obey you all the more until the day of King Jesus' return. Amen. Time for some music now. The song is Before the Throne of God Above, and Martin and Greg are going to lead us. The times, they are a-changing. And as we mentioned last week, as of next Sunday, from Sunday the 21st of June, we will again be holding meetings here in the building. Now we're going to start off small. We're just going to start with two meetings, one at 10 a.m. and one at 6 p.m. So they will be held at the same times as our online church has been these past few weeks. Now, of course, We're not going to be able to fit everyone in just two meetings, with each meeting having to be capped at 50 people. And so because of that, both meetings will be live streamed as well. That means next Sunday, you have a choice. You can either come along here and be part of the actual gathering, or else you can choose to stay at home and join us online as usual at the same time as you have been these past few weeks. But all this means that next Sunday, things will again be different. This online experience will be different. We're going to have to try new types of technology. And so please be patient with us if things are a little bit glitchier next week when you join us online. And here in the actual gathering in this building, it's going to be really different. For starters, we'll need to pre-register so as to make sure that not too many people turn up. Now, you can register for next Sunday's meeting from tomorrow midday. So Monday from midday, you can jump online and register to be here in the building either at 10 a.m. or 6 p.m. next Sunday. But please, before you register, read all the information that's there about the things that you will need to know. There's reminders about not turning up if you are at all feeling unwell. There's reminders to think very seriously about whether you should be here, especially if you're one of the more vulnerable people. There's information about what the meeting will be like, because it's going to be very different. There will be lights, there will be cameras, there will be no singing, there's going to be a whole range of changes, because we want to love our community and therefore we want to take very seriously the government health measures. So please don't turn up next Sunday thinking that it's all going to be back to the same as it was before. Sadly, for the moment, it can't be. And so as we've been saying throughout all this time, we're going to have to be patient with each other. We're going to have to be gracious with each other as we negotiate again a time of change. But even with those changes, it'll be a great joy to be able to meet in person once more. And we're very thankful for that. If you do have questions about what next Sunday will be like, this morning's Zoom morning tea might be an especially good one to join in on. So after we've concluded morning church, hit the link in the church weekly email to join us online for a Zoom morning tea. You'll get to see some familiar faces, but we're also hoping to have a question and answer time about some of the things that will be occurring next Sunday. For now, though, Lee is going to lead us in prayer. And then after that, a very enthusiastic Lyle family are going to share our children's song all about our super saviour, Jesus.
Hi, good morning. My name's Lee, and I'm going to lead us in prayer today. Join with me now. Dear Heavenly Father and Creator of all things in heaven and earth, we thank you for your mercy, grace, and patience. Lord, we thank you that in these challenging times, the rate of COVID infections are reducing in Australia, allowing us to look at how we as a church will start to meet again in person. We are thankful for the technology that has been available to us and pray for patience as the ministry team plan and implement the changes that will allow some of us who are well back into the church to meet together. We pray for Bryson, Tristan and Ed as they endeavour to navigate the complications this brings and as they work towards a functional solution over the coming weeks. We pray for all our political leaders, but in particular for Scott Morrison, Gladys Berejiklian and our health advisers as they make informed decisions, give good advice and guide us in lowering of the restrictions across New South Wales and all of Australia. We pray for those of us that are finding the current situation difficult, isolating and stressful. And we ask our Heavenly Father to provide the peace that comes from knowing Jesus Christ. We pray that we look for ways to support one another, especially with love and in other practical ways during the coming weeks. We pray for peace and reconciliation around the world, especially during this time of protest and unrest, remembering what the Bible says in Ephesians. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another as Christ forgave you. We particularly think and pray for Christians in Cameroon who are experiencing difficulties at the moment. We pray for unity of the Christian groups as they work to share Christ amongst the persecution. Lord, we please give them the strength and encouragement to stand firm, to continue your work, as some need to flee their homes and church activity is being heavily restricted. Please heal those who have been affected by violence and bring them your comfort. We pray also for our brothers and sisters in Christ who may be grieving or are suffering, and for those who are maybe unwell at the moment. We especially think of Joyce, Janet, and Evie Blinko. We pray for all of us as we meet together over the coming weeks in our small groups or one-to-one, whether it be face-to-face or over Zoom, as we learn from your word, your great love, patience, and mercy. Amen.
Time for our Bible reading now. So grab your Bibles, turn to Judges chapter 2. It's a bit of a longer reading this morning, so it will be good to have your Bibles open in front of you. And I caught up with David Burke during the week, who's going to read for us.
David, thanks for reading the Bible for us. And as always, it's really lovely to be able to catch up with how someone's going through this very strange season. And I think particularly for you and Glenda, because you had actually fairly recently only moved to Bathurst before the whole pandemic hit. And so you'd only just started meeting people at church, starting to help on help rosters. Thank you. And then all this happened. So what have been some of the challenges for you and Glenda just fitting into a new church while all this has been happening?
Well, the day we moved to Bathurst was December the 19th last year. And as we drove through Lithgow, we saw the fire coming over the mountains and thought, oh dear. But then, of course, we just started to settle into church after the summer break and starting to get to know some of the 9 a.m. crew, starting to get some good conversations going over morning tea and so on. Bang, all that's gone. So the big challenge has been as though we feel as though we've had a false start in church in many ways, that a lot of that went on hold, although we've found some ways to do some workarounds as weeks have gone on and keep building some relationships. So it's been a bit bizarre to join a church and then the church disappears.
Yeah, sorry about that. So in this time then, have there been things that have been in still able to encourage you as a Christian and help you feel part of the church family?
Yeah, look, I guess a big encouragement behind all of that is that it's still God's world. God's still in charge, that Jesus is still on the throne. God's big plan towards the new creation rolls on, and something like the virus, it's part of the fallen condition, but it doesn't stop what God's doing. So that means every day it's actually worth getting out of bed, even on a chilly Bathurst morning, thank you. It's worth getting out of bed, and life makes sense because God's there behind it. We've found different ways to connect with people around church. So Glenda's been doing one-on-one Bible study with one of the ladies. I've been getting my phone calls as someone who looks after me. And then there's some people around the church that we had around for dinner as soon as you're allowed to have people for dinner. And we had a day out with some people last week. So things like that, we're still making connections.
And, of course, you moved here from Sydney in sort of, well, I don't know really what to call it, because like we've known each other for quite a few years. You're a Presbyterian minister and you had been lecturing at Christ College, the theological college, but you had a non-retirement party at the end of last year when you moved from Sydney. Why did you call it that?
I was keen to call it a non-retirement party because I don't see it as retirement. I've just gone off the kind of payroll and full-time staff of the college. I'm still doing many of the same things I was doing before that non-retirement party happened. So just doing it in a different place in a different way. So, yeah. So we don't see this as retirement. Very much for Glenda and I, it's the notion of there's a new chapter in life. I like to think about the Christian life in terms of being a combination. You believe in Jesus, you follow Jesus, you serve Jesus. You grow in and into him through all that. And whether it's a non-retirement chapter or a pre-retirement chapter, exactly that same set of words apply. So we just keep kind of doing stuff.
Good on you for just living for Jesus, no matter what situation you're in. So what are some of the things that you and Glenda are involved in and looking forward to it in this sort of season of your life?
Glenda retired as a school teacher in December 2018, and since then she's been looking for something she calls the normal life. It's not been like that since then for various reasons, and I think she thought when we came to Bathurst and after we made a nice new home here, there'd be this normal life, but of course that hasn't happened, instead of which she's gone back to teaching, as it were. She's been overseeing schooling at home for some grandchildren who live near us, supporting that household where there's two health workers there and doing some other things. So I think maybe her definition of normality is going to change. I think that'll be the issue. I'd expected to be in Sydney for much of the first half of this year, teaching, doing some teaching back at college and other things. Second half of the year, I was going to be in Melbourne, Bandung, Dili, Seoul, Vancouver, Western Ethiopia, Kuala Lumpur, doing things. Instead of which I continue to do some of those things from home. In fact, around the time this will be broadcast on Sunday morning, I'm actually preaching at a church in Melbourne and then teaching in Bandung, Indonesia during the week. I was going to do that as a commute. Instead, I'll do it all from Bathurst. So all that stuff continues on. It just looks different.
Isn't it amazing how God has been able to use the technology that is available for just gospel ministry to still happen? So let us know, like, why were you going to all those places? Why are you doing, what's your role?
Yeah, my big passion over the last few years is to get involved in ministry training in the majority world. That means in countries where they haven't got colleges and libraries and things like that. And so I've taught people literally sitting under a tree in Western Ethiopia. These were pastors pastoring churches of South Sudanese refugees in refugee camps. And so you just kind of sit on a plastic chair and grab a tree branch when you want to illustrate something. That's my big passion. And in fact, one of the reasons for leaving college at the end of last year was so that we could invest more time and more of our resources into that majority world ministry training. There's about 2.2 million pastors in the world, which is a horrifying thought. Only 5% of them have had any opportunity of formal training. Now, that's scary if the pastors and their churches are new believers. That's a recipe for heresy, for cults, for all kinds of wacko stuff. So I'm committed to doing something about that.
Oh, that's a lovely gospel passion to have. Thank you. Let me pray for you and Glenda, and then over to you reading the Bible for us. Let me pray first. Father, thank you so much for David and Glenda within our church family, and we really thank you for the encouragement that they are in their gospel-mindedness and their desire to serve you as best they can in whatever life situation they are in. Father, we pray that as restrictions relax, there would be opportunity for us to be to be even more of an encouragement, and for us to be encouraged by David and Glenda in this period of change as well. Father, thank you for the gospel heart that you've the gospel vision that you've given to David. We pray that there would be opportunity through technology to still be able to do effective ministry in those areas where his heart's desire is. And now, Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you for the direction and comfort that it gives us. Amen. Thank you. Thanks for reading the Bible.
Great. If you've got your Bible there, we're reading from Judges chapter 2 at verse 6 through to chapter 3, verse 6. So this continues the story of Israel and the land. When Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountain of Gash. And all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work he'd done for Israel. And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and they served the Baals. And they abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who'd brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them and bowed down to them. And they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them. And he sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies, so they could no longer withstand their enemies. Whenever they marched out, the hand of the Lord was against them for harm, as the Lord had warned, as the Lord had sworn to them. And they were in terrible distress. Then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hand of those who plundered them. Yet they did not listen to the judges, for they whored after other gods and bowed down to them. They soon turned aside from the way in which their fathers had walked, who had obeyed the commandments of the Lord, and they did not do so. Whenever the Lord raised up judges for them, the Lord was with the judge, and he saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. For the Lord was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who afflicted and oppressed them. But whenever the judge died, they turned back and they were more corrupt than their fathers, going after other gods, serving them and bowing down to them. They did not drop any of their practices or their stubborn ways. So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he said, "Because this people have transgressed my covenant that I commanded their fathers and have not obeyed my voice, I will no longer drive out before them any of the nations that Joshua left when he died, in order to test Israel by them, whether they will take care to walk in the way of the Lord as their fathers did or not." So the Lord left those nations, not driving them out quickly, and he did not give them into the hands of Joshua. Now, these are the nations that the Lord left to test Israel by them, that is, all of Israel who had not experienced all the wars in Canaan. It was only in order that the generations of the people of Israel might know war, to teach war to those who'd not known it before. These are the nations, the five lords of the Philistines and all the Canaanites, the Sidonians and the Hivites who lived on Mount Lebanon from Mount Baal Hermon as far as Lebo Hamath. They were for the testing of Israel to know whether Israel would obey the commands of the Lord, which he commanded their fathers by the hand of Moses. So, the people of Israel lived amongst the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And their daughters they took to themselves for wives, and their own daughters they gave to their sons, and they served their gods. That's the word of the Lord.
Morning, everyone. Let's pray, and then we'll have a look at this second part of the book of Judges. Father God, thank you for the chance once again to hear you speak and to hear you remind us of the way you love us. Please may we see your goodness to us in Jesus again now. Amen. Have you ever had that awkward experience of having someone introduce themselves to you for the second time, even though you've already met them before? They've just forgotten.
Hey, I'm Lockie. Haven't we already met before?
No, we haven't. I'm Lockie.
Pretty sure we have.
Lockie? No, we...
Now, sometimes that can be quite awkward. There's the potential for embarrassment that rises there. But then sometimes, you know, you've met someone and you actually just can't recall their name. And so it's actually really helpful that they introduce themselves to you for the second time. Today's part of the book of Judges may feel a little bit awkward to you, a little bit like being introduced to someone that you've already met. If it feels that way, well, that's actually because that is exactly what is happening. Here we have a second introduction. Do you remember how chapter 1, verse 1 started? We read it last week. The very first thing mentioned was the death of Joshua. Well, you'll have noticed that's how we started today's reading too. Verses 6 and 7 and 8 of chapter 2 describe how the people arrive in the promised land and then Joshua dies. Suddenly, we've actually jumped back to where we started last week, right back to the start. The author of Judges here gives us a second introduction, this time to summarize for us everything that's coming up in the whole book of Judges. But we'll get to that in a moment. Because for us, this part of Judges is a reintroduction on another level too. It's a reintroduction to God's patient, merciful, and overwhelming grace. And as familiar as we may be with God's grace, it is always worth getting to know it again. And look, even if this is the first time that you've ever heard God's grace talked about, if that's you, this is also an excellent first introduction to grace. So let's jump back to Joshua's death and this new introduction and summary of the book of Judges. We're going to see the problem and the pattern that exists all the way through this book, and then we're going to consider the point of it all. Let's start with the problem. After Joshua dies, the next generation of God's people, they forget God. That's the problem in a nutshell. Have a look at Judges chapter 2, verse 6. It says, "When Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel." This next generation, they'd probably heard about what God had done, saving Israel from Egypt and powerfully bringing them into the promised land and all of that. But they had forgotten what God is like. They had forgotten all of the things that we saw last week, that God is a powerful and a faithful rescuer. And so they started serving other gods. Take a look, verse 11. The people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of the Lord and served the Baals. They abandoned the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them and bowed down to them. And they provoked the Lord to anger. Notice there's two things that Israel do that go hand in hand here. They worship other gods and they do evil. They worship the Baals and Ashtaroths and they provoke God to anger. Now in the world around Israel then, there were lots of different gods. Gods of agriculture and gods of business and love and music and war. And each god had its own little area of influence. And you could just mix and match. You could choose which gods were important to your needs at the time. Now, a couple of things to note about that. Firstly, none of these gods could hold a candle to the true and living God who is powerful over all of life. To worship these gods is an offence to the true God, and it's an affront to his sovereignty. But also, the traditions and practices of these false gods, these idols, they went completely against God's goodness. Worshipping these false gods involves some very disturbing and very unpleasant practices. And the book of Judges will go on to show us more and more of what it looks like to turn away from the true and living God. And it's actually going to go into quite gory detail to show us what happens when Israel turn from their loving and life-giving God to these idols and false gods. There are parts of this book, the book of Judges, that are sickening, just quite nauseating. It really just makes you want to slam it shut and turn away. And this is the problem of Judges. If Judges was a film, it had come with an R rating, and it would be the kind of film that I would never want to watch. And even the Judges themselves, the heroes of the book, I guess, they are violent, they're angry, they're selfish. They win astounding victories, but they do some awful things to win them. The victories they win leave them with blood on their hands. If you've looked at our small group study booklets for this series, you'll have seen that image on the front cover. It's a little confronting, because that's what Judges is, through and through. It exposes the depths of sin. In the New Testament, the Apostle Paul writes about the depths of sin in Ephesians chapter 2. And he also there in Ephesians 2 uses confronting language. He says there that we were once dead in our sin. We were enslaved to evil, following all the passions of our flesh, every desire of our minds. Paul says that we were once by nature children of wrath. See, as awful as the problem of Judges is, it is the very same problem that we have. Without God, we deserve nothing but judgment, condemnation, punishment, because sin had a hold on us. Judges chapter 2 verse 15 says Israel was in great distress. That describes us too, without God. And so for Israel, God sends judges. And here's where we see the pattern of the book of Judges. And this is a pattern that we're going to see repeated over and over again as we read through the book. The pattern is described in verses 16 to 23. The first part of the pattern, God raises up a judge and he saves his people. Take a look, verse 18 says, whenever the Lord raised up judges for them, the Lord was with the judge and he saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. But, verse 19, whenever the judge died, they turned back and were more corrupt than their fathers, going after other gods, serving them and bowing down to them. You could draw it like this. The people rebel. God is angry. They're oppressed by their enemies. They cry out and they repent. And so God sends a judge and saves them through that judge. There's peace, at least for a while, until the judge dies. And then the cycle starts all over again. And notice in verse 19 that whenever the judge died, the people turned back and were more corrupt than their fathers. This is not just a circle, but a downward spiral. Each time round the merry-go-round, it is worse than the last. It's like water circling down a drain, closer and closer to oblivion. It's like watching a tornado pick up speed and leave a trail of havoc and destruction and disaster in its wake. Even the judges themselves are just sucked up into it. Each spiral brings God's people closer and closer to destruction. But notice also in the pattern that God graciously saves his people again and again and again and again. As many times as the people rebel, as wicked as they become, and as often as they forget, he brings them back. They don't deserve it. They far from deserve it. But he rescues them over and over again. Now, this is a summary of the whole book. And so both this section and the whole book of Judges leave us in the end with a tension and a question. How long can this go on? How many times can this pattern repeat? Could this go on forever? And look, honestly, the book of Judges gives no answer to that question. And it gives very little hope. And that's actually the point of Judges. What Judges does is makes us hungry for something better. It makes us long for a solution to this problem, this awful pattern. It makes us long for a permanent solution. It makes us long for a better judge, a better leader. The one tiny sliver of hope is in the fact that God cares for his people in their distress. Every time. Look again at verse 18. It says, the Lord was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who afflicted and oppressed them. The point of Judges is to leave us wanting something or someone better than a flawed human judge. Something more permanent than a human leader who dies and whose achievements just go to waste. Someone who can save our souls and fix people's hearts permanently forever. Now, we're not going to find that rescuer in the book of Judges. I'm sure you've heard the story of the ugly duckling. You know that one duckling that's so ugly that the other creatures just despise it. The ugly duckling gets nothing but abuse until much later when, of course, the ugly duckling becomes the beautiful swan. Now, in the unfolding story of the gospel, Judges is really just the ugly part. But like that old fairy tale, the Bible is one coherent story from start to finish. It's taking us somewhere. And like that old fairy tale, the ugly duckling of Judges anticipates something extraordinarily beautiful. It anticipates the fullness of God's grace. It anticipates a rescuer. Come with me back to Ephesians chapter 2, because after describing how ugly we were and how deserving of wrath because of our sin, the Apostle Paul goes on to show how God has saved us through Christ Jesus. And in doing so, Paul points out that Jesus breaks the pattern of Judges. Ephesians 2, Paul says, God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loves us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you've been saved. Jesus is the rescuer that we need. Jesus is the leader that Judges longs for. Like the Judges, the victory of Jesus is bloody and it is violent, but the blood this time on the hands of the victor is his own. Rather than taking life, Jesus gives up his own life. He's nailed to a cross. And as he is, he takes our sin and he takes our guilt, all that makes us ugly and deserving of God's anger. Jesus dies, and Jesus brings a permanent solution, a lasting rescue. Jesus dies and once and for all brings God's people back to God. And so, more so than in Judges, in Jesus, we see that God relentlessly offers grace to people who don't deserve it, people who don't look for it, people who sometimes don't even really appreciate it when they're saved by it. The book of Judges is not a book full of good examples or role models. I mean, there's a few decent judges, and Othniel and Deborah, a couple of the judges we're going to look at in the next couple of weeks, they're pretty good. They do some really good things. You know, but they're at the start of the book, and all of the good things they do are quickly forgotten. The point of Judges is that the only true Saviour is Jesus. Judges is ultimately about Jesus. In Jesus, God offers grace to lost people, lost sinners. In Jesus, we see God's grace triumph over the darkness of human thoughts, human hearts, human actions, the darkness of our own thoughts and hearts and actions. So God's patient and even God's relentless grace and mercy, they are a great comfort. They're especially a great comfort when we feel trapped in our sin. When we feel that there's no way we're good enough for God. When we've given in to bitterness or anger or resentment or greed or lust again. When we've let things drift. When we haven't read God's words to us in weeks. When we haven't spoken to God, when we struggle to speak to him regularly, when we realize we've made a God out of something else, like what people think of us, when we find that we're caring more about what others think of us than what God thinks of us. In any way that we fall short, what an extraordinary comfort to know Jesus, to know God's loving rescue, his persistent offer of grace and salvation. What a comfort to know that Jesus has broken the pattern of Judges. Jesus restores us to God. And so we can approach God in repentance and in thankfulness and in the joyful expectation that he will change us and he will actually make us into new people. People who, by God's Spirit at work in us, are no longer prone to wander, but ready to do the good works that God's prepared for us to do. For us, God has raised up not judges, but Jesus. So friends, take this second introduction to Judges and take God's repeated bringing of Israel back to him. Take this as a comfort and an encouragement to get to know Jesus' rescue all over again. To get to know God's grace all the more deeply. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the way he breaks the pattern of the book of Judges. He steps in, and at just the right time, he died for us to save us from ourselves, to bring us out of a pattern of sin and enslavement to sin. Father, that's a wonderful rescue, and we know that we don't deserve it. So thank you for being merciful and gracious. God, thank you for saving us into new lives. And please, God, by your Spirit, draw us to you to live for you. Amen.
Still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through.
Well, that concludes Morning Church for today. I'm going to pray in a moment, and then after that, we're going to be having morning tea over Zoom. So once I've prayed, hit the link in the church weekly email and join us for morning tea. Join us to see some familiar faces, and join us especially if you have some questions about what next Sunday will look like when we again resume having some physical meetings here in the building. Let me pray. Father God, thank you again for reminding us this morning of your patient grace towards us. And thank you that we especially see your mercy expressed to us through Jesus Christ. Father, we pray that encouraged by your word, we would continue to trust and obey you all the more this week. Amen. See you over morning tea. Sure.